So I'm going to call this meeting to order at exactly 6 o'clock. And so we need to review and approve the minutes of October 6th. Do I have a motion?
Motion.
Second.
Any questions, comments?
Stellar job, Mr. Allen, stellar job.
I thought it was a good job.
Thank you.
Easy to read.
For a crazy last meeting.
Oh my gosh, yes. All those in favor of accepting the minutes? Any opposed? Does anyone have to abstain? One abstention? Two? Oh yeah, you weren't here, Mary Kay. Financial statements, Patty?
So you got your financial statements via email, and I don't have anything yet to report. I did just yesterday get an update from our SPED director, so I will be looking to adjust our tuitions if necessary. There are 20 warrants to sign in the amount of $1,254,436.30. And free cash was submitted. I'm expecting it back. My guesstimate for certification is $433,036. And our end of year report was also submitted. I brought a copy, which would need the chair and the superintendent's signature. The report has been submitted and this paper will follow. So there's the report, Madam Chair, if anyone needs to review it. And that's all I have.
Thank you. Any questions or comments for Patty? Okay. Student Advisory Council?
She's supposed to be here to comment, so.
Oops, I already checked them off. Thank you, Bill. I'm backing up.
All right, back up.
Okay, public comment? All right, we're good. I had already checked them off, so I moved along. Now, Student Advisory. Can you repeat that?
Still supposed to be here. Gracie said she's going to be here, so.
Yeah, I got it.
Okay, well, you know, when she comes in, that'll be fine.
Thank you. I love that little speech.
So we have unfinished business, the signing of the warrants. If you remember a couple months ago, we asked Patty to look into what was going on. She reported back last week and said that she would then report back again this month.
So in discussions with Mr. Scanlon, who is our auditor, we thought that there was going to be a solution in the Municipal Relief Act. However, we've subsequently found out that the one person signing is not open to regionals. It doesn't include the regionals. So there is going to be legislation filed to get that amended to include regionals. So right now, Mr. Scanlon is saying we can wait, keep doing what we're doing till March, when he's hoping that the amendment will be made and then form that type of warrant signing, or we can do what we should have been doing forever and having three people come and sign the warrants before we release the checks.
But there's a problem with that, Patty.
With a problem with what?
With three people coming, because we were told at the Cape you actually have to have a posted meeting.
Right. Now, I did discuss that with Mr. Scanlon, and he says that he does other regionals, and they do not do that. They have a subcommittee of three people. They come at different times, and they all sign. So he said you can keep doing what you're doing to the amendment. He recommends doing the three people, but not doing the posted meeting, because no one really follows that. Or wait until March and then make the changes.
I personally would like to hear other input and opinions about, because that would be considered past practice if everybody else is doing it, is that correct? Or, like, if everyone else is doing it and getting away with it, then.
It doesn't necessarily make it right.
It doesn't.
So I think there's precedent if everyone else is doing it, but I, since we know that there's now an amendment.
That's coming.
My recommendation is that we don't change just because there's precedent, and I think that we should continue as is. And is there any issue with signing them here, continuing to sign them?
No, but we continue to get written up on our audit report, and okay. We've had this finding for 20 years now, and why not 21?
Yeah.
And then fix it for 22.
What does written up mean?
They'll write right on our audit report that we're not following what we should, that the checks are released before the school committee signs.
But has there ever been an issue where we've had to haul back a check that's already been signed and released?
this is my fifth year. It hasn't happened during my tenure. One of the things that we've done, put in place is that I do review the warrants before they go out. So I'm looking at them.
I mean, that doesn't make it right, but I've been here a while, and it's never...
It's never happened. Right.
It's never been an issue, but it has been in that audit.
Yeah, it's been in the audit for...
Every time.
And so, I mean, since we're going to the committee of one in March, and that's the preferred solution, if we can just expand it by a couple till then, I mean, I go past the building often enough, I can stop it.
But what Bob is saying is, to do it the right way, you have to have a committee meeting, you have to post it.
To sign the warrants?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's what they mentioned at the Cape.
So,
Well, that was news to a lot of the regionals, because they couldn't understand why it wasn't applicable to them. And then they said, well, you're supposed to be posting some, so no one's doing, it was like news to everyone that they were supposed to be posting subcommittee meetings to get their warrant signed.
How does it end up three, when there's 11 of us?
Well, that's what the law says. You could have five, Billy, and...
Well, somebody came up with another three.
Minimum of three.
It's probably the statute may say minimum of three on the subcommittee. I don't know.
If it's coming down in March, I'm okay with just leaving it the way it is. Instead, we're just gonna make ourselves all kinds of more trouble.
The business office is coming here as of about January 1. Okay, so there's no reason that, starting in January, all the warrants can come and go on the table like they used to, because nobody's gonna have to drag them from Waitley to here and then up a set of stairs and then back down when they leave, because the business office is gonna be physically in the building.
Right, but they're still up the stairs and everything else, unless we're gonna have the meeting in my office.
At 5:30.
Here's the problem. It's the checks leaving the building before you guys sign. Okay, so that's the point. And there's some things we can't hold. If we hold the Amex bill until we have a warrant signing meeting, we're gonna be incurring interest charges. So there's gonna be exceptions to the rule for some of our expenses. We can't hold on to the retirement checks. We can't hold on, you know, they've gotta go. We've gotta pay payroll taxes within 3 days of payroll. So and we're not gonna do the same thing for payroll. We're not gonna hold payroll every 2 weeks till someone comes in and signs. I mean, that's the operation of everyone.
It's a major problem with control, and as to what should be done, what's been done, and what have you, and, you know.
And what's feasible and practical.
Yeah.
And I think if there's a correction coming, then we don't really need to change until it doesn't come in March. And we would know it's not coming in March.
So we can look at it in spring.
So let's, we don't have to take a vote on it or anything. We can just sort of table it until we get more information. Keep us abreast of what's going on.
Sure.
Anybody?
But the statute also says that the person of one or the subcommittee of three has to report to the board with all the information.
Right.
So, you know, it's still technically how much information? I don't know, but it does say.
With information.
Yeah.
Okay,
it has to be
so we're
reported.
Gonna.
So, you know, it's a.
I think we're making a bigger mess than we need to, so if we just let it go for a little while and see.
Years ago, the payroll sheets.
That was years ago. Yeah. We're in the 21st century, so, you know.
The payroll sheets were all signed blank.
I think that's a wise course of action.
Moving on to new business, the discussion items is a student AP trip to Washington, D.C. on March 18th through the 22nd, and Ms. Walters and Ms. Moore.
I'm here for Ms. Moore.
Okay.
So she doesn't have to be here.
Okay, so
Here's the itinerary that we have drawn up for everyone. We're taking the juniors and seniors that do AP European History and AP Government to Washington in March for 5 days. So we're going to try and do the same as we have done for the last 2 years. Leave on a Saturday. We've got a bus, staying in a hotel, which is nearer to the center of the city, and we travel on the subway. We would leave here on Saturday morning. We would arrive before dinner time on Saturday night. Sunday is a museum day. Arlington visit, dinner, and sometimes do a movie night. We might change that because the government kids are going to be getting up at 4 o'clock on Monday morning to
go. I was going to ask if that's a misprint, because we're the high school kids at 4 o'clock in the morning.
they are always on time. I don't go. Laura goes.
Two in the morning.
This is the advantage of doing AP Euro is I don't have to leave the hotel until 9 o'clock in the morning because I go to the National Gallery. I do not go to the Supreme Court. That's the seniors that do that, and I take the AP Euro kids to the National Gallery after a later breakfast. So they go stand outside to see if they can get into the Supreme Court. They've gotten in every year, so. Yeah, so, and they've had some bad weather and they've had some good weather. So the Monday would be the Supreme Court, and then we're trying to get hold of Senator Warren, Representative McGovern, and John Lewis again. Last year we couldn't see any of them, but we did see the staffers for Senator Warren and Representative McGovern. Jim McGovern ended up in Cuba on an emergency trip, so we didn't get to see him, but we're going to try and get these three people again, and then we get a tour through the Capitol.
Did you say Senator Lewis?
John Lewis, Representative Lewis, John Lewis, the civil rights one.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, we all crammed into his office and had an amazing time talking to him.
Well, I mean, because you got Ed Markey's name there.
Oh, is she trying to get hold of him too? Okay.
He's
sort of ignored us the past couple of times we've been down there.
So. A lot of people for a long time.
Representative McGovern sees us all the time and brings us all into his office and sits us all on the floor, and it's actually quite good. And then we would come back on Wednesday. So we'd like to ask if you approve, and we're asking kids to decide by next week whether they want to go or not.
Move to approve, ma'am.
Do you have a second? Second? Now further discussion, go ahead.
That's great Chip. I just the various politicians listed. Their offices could all help you to get White House tickets. I don't know if anybody thought of that or not.
It's okay. The line. We've talked about it, and it's the line to go in for a very short period of time, and we try and fit in as many things as possible. And I think that we decided it's going to take a long time, so it would take up most of a day probably.
It's a real hit or miss thing. They cancel at the last minute.
Yeah.
They go there years.
So, and this way, we actually scheduled two afternoons that we could sort of do some maneuvering around, like the Monday and the Tuesday afternoon, to see if we can get in to see them. It gives them some flexibility with their schedule.
I can tell you, it's a tremendous trip for them to go as eighth graders and then return with a different level of inspection of the Capitol.
They love it.
And what they're learning at each place. I haven't gone with them, but I've been when they've come back and have the discussions and what they take with where the levels that they're at now. It's just a nice little building, it seems.
Yeah.
Great.
I sure hope you do it next year, too.
Gonna keep doing it.
It's a cost of $535. Are all the kids that want to go going to be able to accommodate it financially to make this thing work? In the past, they've had all kinds of fundraisers to make sure that every kid that wants to go gets to go. I just want to make sure that if we approve a school function, we should put the money to make sure that the kids, all of them, get to enjoy the benefits of the whole program, if we think that's, if it's a school-sponsored program.
So, unlike the Washington, D.C. trip, which there's 110 students or thereabouts going, they do a lot of fundraising to offset the scholarships because there's more scholarships. I've offset the scholarships through some of the accounts that I control in the past. So we've done some partial scholarships, and that's all that's been required in the past. If there was 10 students who couldn't afford to go, we would have to look at creating fundraisers, because I don't have that kind of money within the principals. It's called School Improvement Fund. It's something where
I just want to make
those kind of trips.
I just want to make sure that no child gets left behind because they're disadvantaged.
Okay? We've got 26 total, and between the two classes, and then there's some from one of the honors classes that might fill in some spots so we can fill the rooms. And right now, I think all of them are working and intending to go if they want to.
Right.
And I think there are three that don't want to go because they went last year.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's fine.
So,
but I want to make sure that if anyone wants to go, that they not go because they, their parents couldn't come up with the dough to make it work.
Okay, so I had a motion, a second, discussion. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, moving on to the New Zealand trip for the school committee. Oh, wait a minute, not for school committee.
Oh, school things in New Zealand?
Yeah, wouldn't that be fun?
They talked about the national conference. I didn't know it was an international one coming.
No one ever asks us to go.
I know.
You two could be
You could be the first.
You are welcome to join us.
And go ahead, babies.
So we'd like to present to you a trip to New Zealand for the students for February 16th through February 24th, 2018. That would fall on the Friday before February break, and then the rest would be during February break. And the goal of this trip is, high school has offered in the past a lot of trips, and even this year, to Europe, and we want to kind of expand the horizons a little bit and offer a trip that goes kind of further. So we looked at New Zealand, and we found a great educational tour company called Haka Tours that are out of New Zealand. They've been doing this for years. They know New Zealand inside and out. And they not only provide a tour guide that stays with you the whole time, but in addition, they provide the accommodations as well. So they actually own their own accommodations. The tour cost would be $3,425 to $3,850 without fundraising, and that's based on how many students go. Based on the interest that we've seen, we have over 25 students and parents who have shown very strong interest in attending the trip, so it'd be more towards the $3,425 range with optional travel insurance of $140,000 that would be provided by, where's this page? By Pioneer Valley Travel, and it would insurance would cover any last minute cancellations or if the trip has to be cut short for any reason, flight delays or changes, medical expenses or emergencies while traveling, lost luggage or stolen items. And on this has listed their travel awards, their recent travel awards as well. And
the entire team was super stoked to receive the prestigious travel award.
That's from their website. That's what they said.
It's more of a hands-on trip. We'll be right there, a lot of adventure, a lot of activity, spending a lot of time outdoors.
Mm-hmm. That's local New Zealand talk.
I'm super stoked. Myself.
And the goal of this trip is coming from a few different perspectives. So we're looking at the students really engaging with and understanding the indigenous culture of New Zealand. Also, through a health perspective, these are all hands-on activities where the students are moving and outdoors. So kind of engaging that aspect of it. And also from an environmental aspect. So there's a lot of preserved lands there that the students are going to be able to explore, as well as the animals and creatures that inhabit those preserved lands, too. And let's see. Also, the tour guide that will be with us the whole time. The tour guide that specifically would be going with ours is a senior tour guide, has been background checked, and also is certified in CPR and first aid at all of the activity locations. So the main ones will have trained medical staff at each of them as well. And then Heather's going to read out the itinerary.
I'm going to read the itinerary. Please pardon that. We're still trying to learn the names of the cities. So we arrive in Auckland, we'll be going to Coromandel.
So day one and two will be travel
days.
Because when we travel, we lose about 17 hours.
Yeah.
That we gain back on the way back home.
The activities, I won't list every single, I have this available to anybody who wants it. It's outside my classroom door, and I'm happy to make more copies now if you'd like to look at it. But we'll be doing some sea kayaking. We'll be going to Hobbiton, which is where the Lord of the Rings was filmed. We're going to do some black water rafting. We're going to go through a glowworm cave. So we'll be calling the environment through there. We are going to do... go to a thermal park, and we're doing the Maitai Maori Village Cultural Experience. We're going to learn about what haka means, the dance, the culture behind that. It's a sun.
You're going to give a demonstration when you come back?
Sure, we'll practice.
Sarah comes and does it with us.
Bobby, it says your parents are welcome.
The parents are absolutely, yeah, anyway, we're hoping that one of you may join us.
And then, so the initial deposit, we would need in a 580 by January 9th, followed by an installment of 385 by March 10th, and then the balance by November 10th, 2017. And we say balance because we have a lot of ideas for fundraising to try and make the trip more accessible. So we have a gift wrapping.
Our first one is December 10th this year, gift wrapping at Barnes & Noble.
But we also spoke with a parent who was very interested in the trip and gave us some great ideas about grants that we could apply for to provide either a discount for all students or to provide some scholarships for students as well. So those are some things we're looking at and open to any and all fundraising suggestions, because the more accessible we can make the trip, the better.
Same argument that I want to make sure any child that wants to go, we should make every effort to make sure that they not be excluded because they can't afford it. And the other thing is, I think it may say that the insurance is optional, but I really think that the insurance should be factored in there, because if something happens and these kids have to come home, you know, something's going to have to be provided, because, you know, so much of a problem with your health insurance when you travel out of the country and getting care. So I think we'd be remiss if we didn't say you should have it. That's my opinion.
New Zealand's a universal single-payer health care system that treats everybody without regard to payment or income. So I think
in New Zealand?
Kids are, yeah. Can
you just Google that?
No.
Yeah. So we should go.
So it's a model health care system. It's a model health care system.
So we should send everybody over and have them take care of whatever they need while they're there?
It's also on the top 10 list of countries to move to. It kind of does win tonight.
And if I could just say, I attended the informational meeting that they had, and there were a lot of good questions asked, and they were able to provide, you know, some good questions, the answers to the questions. So the parents that attended asked a lot of questions about healthcare. And so I think, Bob, to your point, you know, the point was made in several instances, you know, please make sure you buy the insurance.
For you, I mean, the sea kayaking, black water, I'm glad you're taking a first aid trained guide, because it sounds, odds are one of you two is going to need it.
That's why they want the nurse. That's why they want the nurse to go. Bill, that's why they want the nurse to go. On that note, I need to entertain a motion here.
So moved.
Second. All those in favor?
Yeah.
Thank you.
It's an awesome trip.
Thank you. Thanks. Have fun.
Okay, moving along, school improvement
plan. Very. Good one.
All right, school improvement plan. There are many things that are already ongoing that are on it, and I'll kind of go through it, and you can ask me any questions as we go through. One of the things we're working on this year within our professional development days is differentiated instruction, and working with Mike Anderson, who's just published a book, Learning to Choose and Choosing to Learn, which is part of, which is a nationwide. He's a nationwide expert and consultant. He's really kind of pushing us to the... Wait, is there a copy right there?
I just wanted to...
Yeah, I was going to bring one.
This particular teacher, this room has the book on his desk.
Oh, look at that. Almost like product placement.
Yeah.
You can pass it around, actually, if anybody wants to look through it.
Yeah,
but basically, we're really looking at differentiation, as you remember from last year, was one of our goals, and now we're really looking at choice within the classroom and how to bring about choice in within your lessons. And so, in fact, we worked on it all day today as part of our professional development day. Also, we are looking at math coaching in the middle school math for middle school math teachers, and we're using Marcia Abramson, who is also someone who does many of the trainings in Massachusetts, as well as we're looking to adopt a new curriculum in the middle school, and as we are also looking at improving those scores, as you saw earlier this year in MCAS. The next thing we are working on, we're working with Gary Chadwell, who's working with the Johns Collins Writing Program. This year we're trying to get collaboration between the English department and the social studies department to look at writing through the same lens and look for similar outcomes so that we don't teach two different types of, there's different types of writing styles, but at least the two groups are communicating and also communicating within their own department that we have consistency. And I think that's an area we need to grow in. So that we have that there. Curriculum mapping is ongoing. So I'm kind of just left in there from last year. We have the installation and implementation of the new SIS system, as I've talked about before. That's going to be an all-year thing because we haven't developed a schedule through it. Right now, we've gotten through the first progress report period. We got the rollout to parents and community members for PowerSchool, robocalls, all the other good stuff. But we have our first grades close on Thursday this week, so we're going to have our first formal report card coming out through it. So while the bulk of it has been shifted over with each thing that the school goes through its seasonal use of it, it's all first-time use, and we're finding a lot of things we have to correct and fix as we go through. So, we are looking at our assessment systems and practices, and we have an assessment committee made up of, I don't know how many teachers are on that?
Six.
So we have six teachers on that assessment. I thought it was more than that. We've already had three meetings, and we're looking at different... eventually, we're going to looking at how we're assessing at the school. We've been looking at different databases to help with assessment and that tie in with PowerSchool. We're just kind of in the exploratory phase now, but that's with the faculty members and the administration. We're looking at, and I talked about this in my last handout of the principal's report. We're looking at the one-on-one initiative of Chromebooks, rather, in the middle school. We launched that at the beginning of October. And currently, this is the middle school classroom. You can see they're lined up there. Students come in, they take them at the beginning of the day, they carry with them from classroom to classroom. So it's a one-to-one model without the take-home yet. We're rolling that out to see how kids are responsibility-wise and how is it working with, distractions in the classroom to, coordinating that kind of thing. It doesn't take away from learning time. Eventually, the idea is we're trying to figure out how we can get those to be brought home. And so, whether or not they become school devices, or I'm telling you, give me a little bit of my planning thoughts that hasn't actually been ironed out, or whether or not students could lease their own, those kind of things. But that's kind of where we're rolling toward. Now that we have the infrastructure here, and now that kids are using them day in and day out, that's the direction we're going. Also, the new PARC testing is going to be on computers, so we might as well have the students have that comfort level of being able to be on the computers. In the high school, we're adding several more sets of Chromebooks. They're currently being shared by departments, so we haven't got up to the one-to-one model in access. So my kind of philosophy on that has been I want there to be a device whenever the teacher or students want to use it. It's not all about the one-to-one first, just being able to carry the device. It's if you need the tool, you can access one. So we're working out those numbers right now.
How's the responsibility part of things so far?
So far, it's been very good in middle school. They've been impressed with, it does tie up the morning a little bit because it's kids, they got to get their backpacks and they got to go to their advisory, then they go to their first classroom. And then the end of all their times, they have an advisory. they have an advisory class, so they have more time to put them away. So that's the only kind of.
You can't shift it over.
Should I just turn on the mic back in?
discuss in an open meeting.
It's true.
I can still come in. You gotta keep going.
Frank!
The library door shut.
Library door shut.
Yeah, library door shut.
You could put a piece of paper on open meeting.
Yeah, but we're someplace we shouldn't be. Can you just stick the thing in the door?
Someplace we shouldn't be. This is where we were posted to be. You can close it. We talked her out of it.
Well, I already moved them, so we're good.
Now you got me. We have to keep the library door.
All right. Any other questions there, Bob?
Just about the tech, has that been budgeted? And I mean, are you receiving the financial support on this expensive technological?
Right now we have a funded budget for the for technology. It's built into our budget, and it's about the rollover of the labs that we've done every, 3 to 5 years. We roll a lab over. Chromebooks being half the price. Chromebook, you can get a good Chromebook for just about $200. We can do three sets per what we used to be one set of classrooms. So when I say we rolled out and we bought three sets for the high school, you're talking about one classroom setting. And also, our infrastructure, hats off to, Scott Paul. He makes a dollar go a long way. And he's updated the infrastructure where we used to be spending thousands and thousands, tens of thousands each year trying to get different things. It's now in place, so we have a little bit of leftover money to spend toward Chromebooks. So we're good right there. So I'd ask for money if I need it. We're continuing with our social justice forums. This was put together last year when we had some issues in the building in regards about social equity of all students. And so this is a group of was made up of first selected leaders. Both who had positive, not just the leaders of your student council, but all types of leaders in the building. And they meet after school. We've been using some of the Fridays, and a couple staff members will attend with them. And they go over talking about the different levels of equity and access, both in our building and both in the community, and just talk about those kind of things. And it's really a great forum. They've already had one meeting this year, and they're going to continue doing that. And so from that, we are going to look at what we need to change here. So, the professional development calendar, I add that on there because the amount of work that we have to put into creating the professional development that's ongoing. Those 25 Fridays, certainly a lot for Sarah and myself.
Is there plenty to put in those 25 slots?
Well, yes. Okay. Yes, there is. Well, what do you think? I think we said this last year, we front-loaded a lot of these outside speakers to get the ball rolling on a lot of these different issues. So we've had Gary Chadwell in twice talking about the writing. We've had Mike Anderson in now. Today was his third time here. So we've already front-loaded those things. So some of the things like curriculum mapping has been pushed off for later because we wanted to get these other initiatives going. We've been very busy with them, Where am I at here? School schedule. I've asked, as developing the contract, we developed an on-ramp for looking at the school schedule. Right now, our current schedule has got some limitations in it. And as we expanded courses through the years, we've been kind of, duct taping it together and making a lot of creative avenues so that, being a small school, getting the most out of it. And I think it's time that we look at the schedule to see if the 4x4 schedule is the best way to go, or if we should expand it in some way. I actually have a meeting on Thursday this week, the first meeting with the scheduling committee, which is actually a formal group created by the union that's meeting with me. So it's I think we have about 10 teachers. 15 teachers on that committee. So it is, it's not just a top-down driven thing. This is a lot of teachers have voiced they want to take a look at the schedule because they want to be able to either have more offerings. They see students sometimes being limited. If they choose one avenue, they then can't take some other electives. A lot of things that tie up our schedule, as well as AP courses being year long. And so there's a lot of components to it. And I mentioned this to you because if it does go through, it's probably going to have to come back to you because it will be I don't know how they're going to amend the contract. That's going to be put on, you put on Lynn's plate, and then bring back to you. But it's going to be, you know, we'll see where that goes. And I wrote the date time on the date on that is, I'm not sure if we're going to be able to rotate that through this year for next year. That's very ambitious, since scheduling starts once we come back from the holiday break. So, you know, it'll have to be a quick turnaround, or it's going to be a year and a half thing. So we'll see what, after the first meeting, happens.
That is a really big deal.
Yeah. It is. It is. There's a lot of moving parts in that. You know, you have contract parts, because right now the contract's written to block scheduling, and so how does that going to work out there? You have graduation requirements. You have the actual building of the schedule. You then also have a middle school and a high school that's running two individual schedules that intertwine with each other with shared staff that I've, over the last couple of years, really forced the two things to fit so that we could save funding on shared people. It'll be interesting.
So
looking forward to that challenge.
Where exactly is the problem?
Exactly. I haven't found the problem yet. That's why I have it on my. It'll be a challenging thing.
Choose to learn, sir.
Choose to learn, right?
You have 15 teachers to help you, right?
Yeah.
And that's the important part on this, is that if I can get, early input and buy into what we're trying to go and come together to a common direction, I think even through a lot of side conversations, we're heading down the same road right now, at least in the same direction, and we just need to get in the same road, I guess.
Right. It's definitely impressive that teachers will come together with you to help meet the needs for the children. Mm-hmm. What's the best thing for the students? Can we offer them more choice? Can we, continue the high quality AP classes but offering more? Right. So I'm excited for the whole process to take place, and I hope that we can support what we come up with.
And I do applaud Darius again, because in negotiations, the schedule came up in several conversations. Conversations that were tabled, but several conversations. So getting ahead of it is a good path.
Yeah, instead of waiting, I think that we're asking a lot, and it's a lot to walk into with a brand new CBA, a brand new contract. But, to address the needs of the kids and put the students foremost in this conversation is what's really impressive. Excited.
Thank you. The next thing is, we're looking at the library. This is kind of a carryover from last year. We talked about kind of refreshing the library. As you know, we did receive a donation. Is that in our hands yet?
Yes, the money is in our coffers.
All right, so from Mr. Mark, from Charles Mark, one of our neighbors, who's donated the money to us, and so we're looking at how to use that. It's that alone's only, I guess, kind of starting the a lot of money, but still only going to start regarding the whole, you look at the carpeting in that room and some of the other envelope issues. And I think that's going to probably go when we talk about the 5-year plan. Well, when I get to that, I'll talk about that. But, you look at the furniture in that room, a lot of the tables are, they're rickety because they're wooden, they've kind of fallen apart. We re-screwed them several times. It's just, things are getting tired. They're 20-something years old now. And it's a high usage place, and so look at that. So, and again, that's probably eventually going to come back to again Lynn and then you folks regarding what are we going to do about the ongoing. And I know I am skipping down to the maintenance and facility plan about the different areas of this building that need refreshing, not renovation but refreshing. Stair treads that are out, and heating systems that we are constantly fighting with. Those kind of things. So. Put it on your radar. You want that. If I'm taking on scheduling, you take it on that.
Bob's the right person to help you with that.
So, right. Bob is putting together, and that's what it said in the last one, he's putting together a 5-year maintenance facility plan, and I don't, that's still in production, so I don't know where that's at this point. But, we're meeting to go through all the different odds and ends, and then we got to create a priority list and then figure out how we do funding on that. So, now that our debt has been paid off, it might be something I could hint toward going toward. Anyway, moving right along, we are also looking at, Lynn and I have been meeting with Deb Zimowski regarding the to redesign our food service program. We were looking at improving quality, looking at the whole, what is provided, how it's provided, and also looking at that the bottom line money. And you know, we had a good loss there last year, and we need to fix that. And so, well, not just looking at the X's and O's, the dollars and cents, we also want to look at the quality of the food. And so we're putting a plan together to launch that within the month, to improve some of the offerings and improve and add more offerings and hopefully also lower the costs as well. So that's what I have there. And so
I've got a question, and it deals with scheduling, but not the scheduling that you were just talking about. With the construction, I know kids are having a difficult time getting to their lockers and then getting to class on time. Has that been, is that getting resolved? Is there a solution that they can look forward to?
So,
because the congestion in the hallway is such that, you know, kids who need to get to their lockers can't because they're kind of squished together more than they were like last year. Making it really difficult for them to get to classes on time.
That has not been a problem that's been brought to my office. Hmm.
So we, wait a minute, can we have some clarification?
What are we constructing?
What are we talking about?
So we moved the locker bank in the lower end of what was the seventh grade middle school wing. Okay. We've had enough lockers where we would have a student every three lockers. Mm-hmm. So they had more space. Okay. When we decided to close off that wing for the superintendent's office, we moved the seventh grade to either the other side, where they were not using those lockers, maybe a couple of the lockers years prior, and all the lockers upstairs. So the amount of spacing between lockers is what I'm guessing is the when you say congestion, has gone to it's one, and then there's a couple. If there's either one every two, or then there's a couple there. We try to put in spaces to allow more room, but it's not as much as it was. And so I'm guessing that's where we're talking about the where there's a congestion. Students in the middle school go to their lockers every two classes, not every class, because of that kind of up and start and finish, you know, start and finish time to between classes. So they start their day off, they go to two classes. I believe they put a break in as part of that transition. And so, I mean, I will talk with the team leaders and ask if that's ongoing. That it's an ongoing issue, but there's a break in between the first two classes and the second two classes, and then they have advisory, and then they go to exploratories, or they go to exploratories first, go to their lockers, and then go to their first two classes. So I can see where that is, but it hasn't been like on my desk as a ongoing concern.
Okay.
So.
Well, it could also possibly talk to you about it. Be stopping at the teacher level. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, she came to your office. Ms. Allen was there. The three of you talked about maybe releasing.
Yes, we did do that. So the beginning of the school day, all the middle, seventh and eighth grade go to the cafeteria. Mm-hmm. And so they have, they've staggered the release to reduce the congestion in the hallway when they go to the middle school end. When they're going to the high school end, they can release all at once because they're going, the amount of different directions they're going up and down, that kind of thing is not as bad. So we did put that in place. But in between classes, I haven't, you know, that morning thing we just, but I'll ask and see if it's an ongoing.
Okay.
I'll ask Jason and Maureen about that.
Anything else? Speaking of construction, how are the buses, that issue with the bridge, how's all that going?
After the communication of that being put out, I have not heard anything, and, you know, Patty runs the communications with the bus company.
Yeah, I haven't had any complaints from the principal saying that they're late, either here or at Deerfield. I've had one parental complaint the first day.
Yeah.
That we were a few minutes early before they could get down their driveway, but that corrected itself.
Provisions in our contract with the vendor, I'm sure this changes his dynamic completely.
The only thing that changes is live miles. We didn't increase the number of buses. We just moved everybody around to it, so we're okay. His live miles have changed, but that's
for sure.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. But we didn't add any. We didn't have to add any bus routes. We just moved everybody from here to there.
Judy, did you have something?
I just wanted to ask, as part of the lunch improvement, which I'm excited about, is there anything? Have you talked at all about improving the interface for how you pay and like the ability to pay at the family level versus the individual level or anything like that?
We are talking about that. To get a system, other school systems have it, where parents can go online.
Just pay for that money?
They can put money in, connect it to a credit card, have it withdraw a certain amount per month, or what, you know, there's different setups on that. But we did talk about that and putting that in. So
one of the drawbacks with that is we've yet to find a system that won't charge you for charging your lunch. And the parents have to take that, have to bear that cost of charging. And I've done it in other school districts, and we've put it in place, and then parents don't want to use it because there's a $2 service fee. So we can go down that road, we can find a vendor, but that'll be, it'll be a $2 to $3 service fee for you to do that every time you do it.
I would think there's some off-the-shelf software.
Power School, I think, has a capability, Power Lunch.
But you have to find a bank, and the bank's going to charge the parents.
So, you know, it exists. My kids have it at their school system, and it's $1.50 for each withdrawal. And so I will put, you know, $50 into the lunch, and so I have to pay $51.50 for that lunch, for that service, the convenience fee or processing fee of the money. So over the course of a year, I spend $7 on, you know, every few months, I take out 70, whatever the, I don't even know what I spend anymore, but that's, it is, that's how they make their money, to give you the service of taking the credit cards and doing that kind of stuff. So, but it is something that's out there. We've looked over that stuff before.
So if they send in a check?
Right now they carry it in a check, old school, paper in hand, hand to cashier. Cashier puts it into the account, we deposit it.
We do that now.
That's how we do it now. So they have an account, you know, they put in their code, their name comes up and it says, you know, Lynn, you have $35 in your account. We deducted today, you have $31 left. You know, that kind of thing. And so that's how it works. But the problem with the current system is that, you know, you don't know, the communication goes through the students. So you come through the line and you know what, you have about two lunches left. And you gotta go home, remember, tell parents, get another check, bring the check in. Whereas the automated system sends you an email and says, time to deposit, or you automatic deposit. So, I mean, I understand with the cost thing, I don't know, if our parents would be willing to do that.
Do we feed them if the account is empty?
Sir?
Do we feed them if the account is empty?
Yes. We will front for a couple lunches, and then they get a reduced, they have to, they're allowed to take up a debt. I think it's probably close to around $10. So it's about three lunches, and then they are offered a selection of very basic sandwiches and milk and fruit. So, you know, the sun butter sandwich or the cheese something sandwich. It's not the full hot entrees, but we front them or whatever, we give them a loan to about up to $10.
And this is the only school where we don't have a problem with debt. Every other our elementary schools, we've got parents that owe us $600, $800 for lunch. They're doing it very well here. We don't have an issue with parental debt.
That's had to go on for a long time to get up to $600.
Or not have a lot of kids.
Well, if you got a couple of kids running around in there.
Can I have a motion to approve?
Motion.
Second. All those in favor? Unanimous.
This is an excellent, excellent meaty school improvement plan. Thanks for tackling some of these
committee
things.
Committee Chair, I have nothing. Collaborative?
And nothing. We meet next week.
I think we skipped the budget calendar.
Oh, I apologize. Gosh, it's been a long day.
Come on, Cindy.
It doesn't need a vote. I wasn't looking. Budget calendar. I saw that.
Patty. So we put together the budget calendars for this year. So starting next week, Dr. Carey and myself will be meeting with the principals to go over our initial budget meetings. During the week of December 5th, the superintendent and I again will meet with all the district administrators, our curriculum directors, technology, maintenance. And then during the week of the 12th, we'll have our first draft of our budgets done, which we will review with the superintendent. And then through December 30th, we'll be getting them ready to go to school committee. We have down here for the subcommittee meeting January 5th at 4:30. That's a date that we picked, and we need your input if that's going to be feasible. I was just looking at the calendar. I forgot that I'm going to lose like almost a whole week of transition. So I don't know how early I'll be able to get you the budget to review before we have the meeting on the 5th, because we're going to be moving. I forgot about the week of moving. But I would hope to get it to you for the 30th so that we can meet on the 5th, and then our meeting to present it to the committee would be on the 10th. So the subcommittee, we'll have to post that meeting. Is January 5th at 4:30?
Thursday.
We're going to have the budget before the meeting on the 10th so we can look at it.
Possibly. I'm not making any promises.
Or you can look at it during that first meeting.
I don't know. I have no idea what it's going to look like, but that gives the budget subcommittee one look at it.
Before
we present it to the whole committee.
That never works out well.
And
no,
everybody in this room knows it. It's no surprise. Once it gets in here, it's out the door. I don't care what we tell people to do with it or not to do with it. It's on the counter at Jerry's the next morning, and everybody knows that. That's not a secret. So I'm just a little apprehensive about having only one. Maybe it's going to come in at minus 5%, and we only need one meeting.
Yeah.
The eternal optimist I am.
There you go.
But it doesn't give the budget subcommittee much wiggle room, because we do get cranky some years. And that's only one meeting, and then you guys are, you know, going to see it on the 10th. I'm not sure I don't know how that's going to work.
This is just a good point. What is the deadline to having the budget? March, correct?
We have to have our March 14th is the public hearing.
Okay.
So what I'm proposing for that is to have the public hearing at 6 with our meeting immediately following, not at 7 o'clock, immediately following, so that if we are done at 6:15, we don't have to wait 45 minutes to start our meeting. So I'm gonna have Donna start saying that the meetings will immediately following the close of the public hearing, our meetings will start. Because we did get hung up a couple times in a couple school districts last year. No one came to the public meeting, and then we had to wait around 45 minutes to start our regular meeting.
So back to the more than one meeting. What meeting is on the 17th of January?
What do you mean?
Is there a
Sunderland?
Sunderland.
Mm-hmm.
Don't shoot the messenger here. Could we flip our meeting with Sunderland and have Sunderland meet on the 10th and us meet on the 17th, which would give you another week to have another meeting? Or is that just too soon to
have? If anything, I'd flip us to the 24th, because I have to get Sunderland. Sunderland doesn't have a subcommittee meeting, so I have to get Sunderland their budget. So what I do in my pecking order, I get Frontier done first.
Okay.
Because you guys are up first, because mm-hmm. I have to have a subcommittee meeting. So if you move Sunderland to the 10th, that means I got to get Sunderland's budget done first.
Okay, so if we move to the 24th, just thinking out loud here, if we moved our meeting from the 10th to the 24th, that would give you an extra 2 weeks as a subcommittee.
As like I say, I don't know if we're going to need it, but if we don't have it, then
I think
agree.
If we plan from on January, the pro side, then we move the meeting.
I think I agree. I think you should try to put that in. We got crunched last year. Mm-hmm. You know, it's going to be. You know, Dr. Carey's first time through, I think a little extra time. If you wanted to go back and review stuff, I think it's just getting more time, and that makes sense.
I think you
agree. We kind of got
a
crunch last year.
So, the other thing we were going so early that we didn't have our health insurance rates, which was not a good idea, because we knew they were going up somewhere between 3 and 7%, which is a big range. So this way, if we go to the 24th, at the first meeting we may not have it, but at the second meeting I will probably most definitely have a better estimate of where our health insurance, because rumor has it we're going to be seeing another substantial increase again this year.
So is everyone okay with moving our meeting up to give them a little bit more time to bring us more information?
It's necessary.
I think we should plan on moving it, and then we should just do that.
How about?
And then if we don't need it, okay.
I mean, this, you don't even, unless you have a place for another meeting, you don't even have a chance to get a question answered before.
Exactly.
There's not four of us anymore, there's 11 of us.
Right.
So if you're going to do it that way, then skip the four meeting completely and let's do 11 of us just have at it. It doesn't make any, sense to mm-hmm. me. You got to let that, my committee do its work.
Correct.
And you got to give me time to do it.
Okay, so.
Can I ask a little question?
Go ahead.
Bill, if, can anybody tell me what the day the 5th is?
Thursday.
Okay. Is there a problem, and I'm not on the subcommittee, is there a problem, if it's on a Thursday, is there a problem having a meeting like on Monday morning?
Well, it only becomes a problem with what we're asking them to do. Because they got, you know, if we're asking them to do some, produce for us some
document or
some major magic, you know, they need a couple of days to pull it up. That is good, but, you know, you need at least a day
Thank
or
you,
two.
Mr. Sean.
You need a day or two to, you know.
And that Tuesday is the first day back at work after the vacation.
Yeah, no, yeah, right, because we're off on the 2nd. So you don't get back until the 3rd. So if you have it on the 5th, you have 2 whole weeks.
Right,
and
so
a day.
We could actually do the 5th and the 12th.
Yeah, and if need be, you could do that Thursday too, then, the 14th, if you have. If the water gets that deep, that gives us plenty of room for those of us on the subcommittee to maneuver this thing and make it work.
Okay, so can I have a motion to move the meeting on January 10th to the 24th?
Motion.
Second.
All those in favor? So we can have Donna put that on the schedule right now. It's a done deal. Thank you. And.
Do we have to vote the tentative in that February meeting?
Do we have to what?
Vote the tentative February 7th.
Is that?
Yes, you have to vote a tentative.
Is that what the reason of agreement is?
I think so, yes. I mean, that's
so that gives
historically,
us,
that's what we've done.
That gives us 2 weeks in between two meetings.
So we're going from the 10th to the 20th.
There's four of us.
Okay.
Who was the
first?
Yeah, you,
Phil,
you, and Keith.
Patty can, or Lynn. If you can do me a favor with this, I'm not prone to read my email too often. So if you want to make a change in the meeting date or do something, come, let me know. Because sometimes I miss things because I don't look at my email for 2 or 3 days. I just don't.
I just want to make sure I get, I'm going to put your cell phone in my
phone. I'm not a computer critter, so.
Okay, so everyone understands December meetings are the same, but then January we're not meeting on the 10th, we're going to meet on the 24th. The budget subcommittee is having their first meeting on the 5th, and then they will determine when they have a second meeting, if they need that second meeting, and then they'll bring us the information on the 24th, and then everything else here is the same, correct?
Can I cause a little bit more trouble before
Absolutely.
We go further? What the regional agreement calls for a tentative budget figure to be voted is February 7th, the drop dead.
That's our meeting for that month.
Well, I'm just looking for
correct
the possibility that
right
this committee may need two yeah time. A lot of us may need two
right
shots at it.
No, I don't disagree.
And we got you need to fit that, and maybe you need to slide the February one back a little bit too, just in case. Because it's a lot for here, we bring it in and here to the rest of you guys. Here it is.
And
make a decision tonight. Could you make a decision tonight, please?
Yeah,
okay,
but
we,
how many times have you ever had to do that? I'm just if more than twice. If you get two spaces with moving the 10th to the 24th, how many other times have you had more than two times meeting?
No, I'm not talking about the budget subcommittee. I'm talking about the whole
the
committee.
Entire committee.
So
the whole committee
meeting
needing two
seven
shots at it.
Right, because what else happens during this time is that each town and usually invites us to their FinCom or to meet with the select board to present our budgets. And we're going and presenting and just like you're saying, Mr. Smith, it's on Jerry's table, so then it's gospel. If Dr. Carey and I are going and presenting these budgets, and even if we say these are tentative, they have not been voted.
But I'm not, I don't know how anybody else feels, but I'm not a real big fan of somebody handing me something at 6 o'clock. Here's the budget, we need to vote on it later.
But you're gonna be handing that to us on the 24th of January, and then we have
yeah,
the 7th
the
of
7th.
February.
And I, if the meeting's the 24th, it definitely can go out prior to the 24th.
And
I think we're good, Bill.
Bill, that's why we have a subcommittee. Like any subcommittee, there's a subcommittee for a reason that we're listening to your subcommittee to everybody else that's not on the subcommittee.
That didn't quite work out a couple years ago.
Well, I'm just. It's like negotiations, where there's a few of us to go negotiation, we come back, we present it, and things are usually...
But the thing about, different than negotiations, Bobby, is that the budget subcommittees are public meetings. They're posted, and any board member can go and sit there. He can't tell them what to do, and he can't really participate. But if somebody wants to go and absorb it all, they can. They may not be welcome, but they can.
So could we possibly schedule a second meeting in February and then cancel it if we don't need it?
Yeah.
So I can't see moving the... We've got that meeting scheduled for the 24th of January. Then we have another meeting in 2 weeks on February 7th. If we took and added a meeting, I don't know...
Hold the 21st open.
The 21st? Do we have anything going on the 21st? I don't care.
Yeah, but between the 24th and the 7th, we get to talk about it twice.
No, correct? What I'm saying, Bob, is let's just put another meeting in there now, and we can cancel it. It's so much easier to cancel a meeting than it is to...
No, you get... I don't consider the 24th to talk about it, because I can't talk about something I haven't read yet. You handing it to me and asking me to talk about it, let's talk about it tonight. You know, that's why I'm just floating the idea of a second meeting out there. If you guys don't want to do it, that's fine with me, but there's a lot of years.
What
I don't
do we
know
have
how
on
the rest of you guys feel. I feel like the gun is being held to our head on the budget subcommittee, because we've got to make the regional...
All our meetings are done.
Well,
so why don't we schedule a tentative school committee meeting for the 28th of February if we need it. If we don't need it, we just cancel it. But at least we have it on the books. Because the closer it gets, the harder it's going to be to schedule it.
How hard is it? I mean, I understand what Bill's talking about. We're just getting something one night. Can't we get these budget books before that?
We haven't got budget books for a while, have we?
Okay, they're no longer going to be a book, Mr. Okay. Decker. They are the budget package.
Okay, I'm just asking, is everybody getting a package?
Yes.
Okay, but we can get the package when these guys, the subcommittee gets the package, can't we?
No. They don't want to do that.
No,
they want to horse trade a little bit.
Well, he was talking about having...
That's the whole purpose of the thing. Okay. If you want to do that, then forget the subcommittee. Let's bring the packages in here and let's have a free-for-all.
Okay, so what we have right now, people, is January 5th. The budget subcommittee is going to meet. They can decide whether they need 1, 2, or 6 more meetings.
Oftentimes do not
need that. But you now
give the information up to the full committee.
But you
committee
now
right away.
Have the room to do it if you need it. We are canceling rescheduling our January 10th meeting to January 24th. And then we have a meeting already on the 7th of February. We are also scheduling a tentative meeting on the 28th of February, which may or may not happen, but at least we have it. Everybody cool?
Mm-hmm. So can you vote the tentative on the 28th of February, or it has to be the 7th?
No, we have the 7th. We're not moving it. We're adding.
I'm talking about when the vote's going to take place.
I'm looking at the regional agreement, and all that stuff about tentatives and everything else were superseded and were overridden in 1998, which we're left with pursuant to Mass General Law, Chapter 71, Section 15M. We need to adopt an annual operating and maintenance budget for the next fiscal year, not later than 45 days prior to the earliest date on which the business session of the annual town meeting of any member town is to be held, but not later than March 31st, provided that said budget need not be adopted prior to February 1st.
In town meetings start in April.
That's the final budget. Right. Talking about so that, we're 45 days before town.
But there's
meeting.
Nothing else that says anything about a tentative. It was all overridden with that. I mean, in 1981, it said that we needed to adopt it by the first Monday in January.
Yeah, we used to ignore that blatantly because you just can't do it.
I still
it's not possible.
I don't see any problem with that.
And then we have our March 14th for our final budget.
I do not want to have to unring the bell. I've done it before, and it's not that easy to do.
Let's get a motion on the 28th.
Somebody needs to do their work before it becomes
one more question.
Public.
Does January through March 17 meetings with the boards of selectmen and finance committees. We shouldn't be really meeting with the boards of selectmen and finance committees until our board has decided what direction we want to go in. Okay? And if you start to go and somebody makes an agreement in January that what the budget's going to be, we're sort of boxed in.
They can come on the 14th.
But Bob, we can, what are we going to say? We're not coming?
Yeah.
Yeah, let them come on the 14th when we have a public hearing. If they have questions,
I don't want to get boxed. I don't want to get boxed in early.
Well, we're not saying, it's not boxing in. We go and we say.
Yeah. We actually have done both. They've come on the 14th and then we've gone to the town. Yeah.
I mean, I think from their angle, they're just looking to get the information as early as possible.
Sure. Right. They want someone here.
I understand it, but we got into problems before when we didn't. We presented something before it was approved.
And so, I don't think last year the we didn't go anywhere until after we had a final.
That's not true. We were in Sunderland in January.
My
point is we shouldn't be there until this board has actually voted the tentative budget.
Well, then we'll just tell them that Mr. Decker refuses to allow us to.
No, we won't.
However, the board can direct the administrations not to talk about the budget.
Exactly, that's what I'm saying.
That's how you're the representatives of the town.
But let me just tell you, by going these past couple of years with Marty, we've built up some goodwill with the towns, and now we're looking to shut that down again.
We are not. We are not. We are not looking to shut it down with you people. We are on camera, people. We are just putting some thoughts out into the air. So I really would like a motion to hold a tentative meeting. I would like a motion for another school committee, a second school committee meeting on February 28th.
So moved.
I'd like a second. All those in favor?
Wait.
More discussion?
Wait.
More discussion?
Slow down.
See, the book says don't ask for more discussion.
You have to.
But
discussion is not supposed to take place until the motion and the second
Mary.
Being given.
So I just wanted to respond to Patty about, I mean, I think if they want to give us information and you're invited in January, that's fine. I don't think we're ready to impart anything. And as soon as you start doing that, you're in trouble.
It's done.
And I also don't think, just my opinion, that Patty and Lynn should be there without school committee.
Correct.
I agree.
It's our budget.
I agree.
For the towns?
Technically, yes, you are the ones with the answers. You answer everything that we can, but I think school committee people should be there.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense.
And that should be your response to requests.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because the requests always go directly to you guys. And
but we always let you know when they are.
Yes, no, I'm not saying that, but I'm just saying I think I want to make sure it happens that way.
But some towns do schedule their budget. That's how they schedule their budget hearings. Mm-hmm. So they have the schools on this night, and they have like the fire department on another night so that they can get all their hearings done. So, I mean, and I appreciate what everyone's saying, but I don't know how to tell the towns they need to accommodate.
You don't have to tell them anything right now.
You can just
defer to the chairman.
Send all the administrative assistants in the four towns a memo saying, here's Frontier's budget calendar.
Right now, this is what we're
this doing. Is the way we're going
to
do it. If you want to know something about the budget, you may not know it until, I don't want them to ask us to come and go, no, we're not coming.
Right, correct.
Let's act rather than react and tell them, this is what we're going to do. And they can ask us whenever they want. I don't want
to
turn down.
We'll be available to talk about it after the 28th of February.
I like that. So just so everyone knows, 45 days prior to our first town meeting would be March 16th.
So you'd have to have a final budget figure on March 16th.
March 14th.
Which
when our next meeting
makes sense to have a possible meeting at the end of February if we need it.
If we need it.
Right, because then we have our regular scheduled meeting on March 14th.
Yes.
We need a vote.
I know. All those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous.
Okay. So we'll adjust the calendar and send it back out.
And it's not going to include the meetings January through March with the selectmen and the finance committees.
It could be in March.
Yeah.
It won't be in January.
Just put March 17th meeting with selectmen and finance committees.
I don't usually put those meetings on the calendar. We usually just put
Well, if we said we're going to send them a copy of the calendar.
Yeah, right.
So we'll notify them.
Yeah, whatever towns are asking for us, those particular school committee members go to your town. With Lynn and with Patty.
Well, years ago, the towns used to hold a hearing in the town.
You got my cell phone number.
They'd go to Conway.
Yeah.
The Conway board members would meet in Conway and Deerfield and Sunderland. That's how they did. Didn't really?
Well, we usually do it the same night that we're doing the elementary budget.
Yeah.
So we usually do elementary and Frontier. So we have usually Cindy's usually there for Frontier.
Right.
And then whatever school district that we're at that night, we right. have school committee there.
Sure.
So Mary and Ken are usually there for Deerfield. Mm-hmm. And what's Darius right? comes with us, and so does the principal.
Okay. So moving along, the principal. Principal's report.
I'll do the long. Yeah, quick thing here, because I did the long. So you guys are going to get the superintendent's report. This is long.
We're moving to temp.
All right, I'll be quick though, because this is
moving
good
to temp to the
24th. Everybody got the. I got wine. It's big, but it's good. You guys should get this for many of you, but it's one of those things I think.
No. Oh, you want more?
This is pretty thick.
Oh.
This is thick. This is a report put together by Guidance, and I think in the past years it's been presented to you. But people are always asking, you know, where are kids going for colleges? What is our, you know, what our percentages are from year in, year out? And this is just a plethora of information, kind of just going through, you know, 88% of our graduates last year went on to college. You can kind of go through, the numbers are actually easy because those 98 kids, so your percentages are pretty darn close to.
What's the difference between the undecided number one and undecided number two?
Excellent question.
There's
obviously some indecision there.
Oh.
That must be a typo.
Actually, if you know, notice, it was zero out of zero.
Are there none or is there one?
No.
Because they're both listed.
There's one.
If there's like one kid in the center of town just walking in a circle, that's the undecided one. I think there was. I'm trying to think of who there
must be at least one.
There's probably at least one. Yeah.
It must be the one that says there's.
It's page two said there's one graduate that's undecided, or page three, I guess, not covered. Where there was another kind of a second tally. All right, and you can see where they went geographically, which is kind of interesting. How many people stay in the Northeast? I believe this. The fourth page is acceptance list. I believe that was a request by some people in the community who want to know where our kids are getting into colleges. And so many times students will get into schools that they don't attend because they didn't get the financial aid package. They want to stay close. They end up wanting to stay close to home. Other, you know, family decisions, that kind of thing. Or they accept to a four-year university and then they end up having to go a two-year college route because of finances. So those kind of things. Or they plan on going for 2 years at the community college and then transfer into 4 years. And you can look at the trends over time, but I just think it's interesting information. We're in a good trend.
Tied the all-time high this year.
Yep, we are in a good trend overall. You know, and you can kind of go through and just kind of digest that. But that's my principal report for you. Okay. Since a lot of other things came out of us.
We're slackers still.
Out of the four people going in the military, how many guys, girls? Do you know?
Maybe it's four boys. Yeah.
Good.
You know what? I think it's three boys and one girl. I don't want to be wrong on the camera.
Are you undecided?
I rephrase that. I'm undecided. But zero or one.
You didn't hear a remark. Are you undecided?
How long after they graduate do we still keep that on them? Do we have that on their first entry into job markets and how much money they're making after 5 or 10 years?
We back about 5 years ago when Marty was principal, she paid a company that did that would reach out, and we had like 19% information back rate, and it was such a low thing that we paid, I don't know, hundreds of dollars for them to do it. So we don't have that, and it is, you know, when you look at different studies and stuff, it's not only do you get in college, how long do they last, how do they get through? We don't have any data on that. We are gonna be inviting all our graduates of last year's back the Friday before vacation to talk about their first semester with us. So those invitations are going out next week, and they're gonna present to our seniors. That's a principal report for next month.
There you go. Okay, moving along, superintendent. Thank you. So,
I had the pleasure of attending the Massachusetts Association of School Committees and the Massachusetts Association of School Superintendents joint, annual joint conference last week, and the six board members or committee members that joined me are listed. Philip was there, Bob was there from Frontier, we had three members from Conway, and Sunderland and Deerfield. So it was wonderful, and some of the workshops were really, I found to be really good. The OPEB legal considerations, you know, practical strategies for children, supporting children with oppositional, was very interesting to me. That was, it's not what you think when these students are behaving and acting up like that. There's really something going on. And so one of the things they talked about, which I had always suspected, they have done some research and they found that incentive programs don't generally work with these children who are struggling with their behaviors and their control and their impulses. It's, you know, a behavior plan, an incentive program. These things really don't work, particularly because we want to have them have more intrinsic control and intrinsic motivation to do well, not extrinsic, some kind of treat or some kind of, you know, plus that they get. Mostly they're acting out, they're looking for attention, and they're looking for attention from adults, and there is anxiety involved, and they're scared, and they really don't, their needs just aren't being met. And it's very hard to have a child like that in your classroom if you're a teacher. It's very, very hard. And it's also hard to take a step back and look at what's really going on with the child. And we think we know, we think we can sense, but it just made me really stop and think about the kinds of attention that we give and the kinds of attention that children need. So we had some, you know, a lot of social emotional learning, building and managing relationships, and Chapter 70 in net school spending. All of this was very interesting. So to come to the high school, middle school, Frontier, our students in grade 7 and 8 will be taking the computerized MCAS assessment this spring. And we chose this option. 8th graders, I think, were expected to do it. I think it was 4th grade and 8th grade, or 3rd grade and 8th grade. But we had made a decision as an admin team that all our students from grades 3 to 8 will be taking the test on the computer. And one of the things, you know, that made it easier for us to decide is that we'll be held harmless while we're making this transition to MCAS 2. So not only will the students get used to it, be exposed to it, get used to it, the teachers will understand how the whole system works. We have made great strides in our computerizing, our one-to-one computer program, particularly in the middle school and in the elementaries. We have enough that we can do the testing. We have made provisions so that we are able to do this. We want to test our infrastructure, we want to test our technology, we want to test or process the students, let the students, you know, learn the process and be exposed to that. So we're excited to see what will happen. So while we're transitioning to the state mandated testing, computerized testing, we're going to go be held harmless, which is always a plus. Mm-hmm. So one thing I just wanted to talk to you, just for your notification, I'm not asking for anything at this point in time, but I've been meeting with the Massachusetts Rural Schools Coalition. At the last meeting, I went to State Senate President Sam Rosenberg was there. He has been part of a committee that has developed an act called the RISE Act, and it's Reform, Innovation, and Success in Education. This act is a little different than what the rural schools is looking for, but the RISE Act was passed, I think I'm right, and I could be making a mistake, but I believe it was passed by the Senate but not the House, and so they're going to resubmit it next year and see if they can't get a little bit more through the House. But it's really about the charter schools and how we can, how they can offset the costs that we're coming across with the charter schools, but also to get some accountability in the charter school program. The teachers in charter schools don't need to, as we all know, don't need to be certified by the state. Their committees are a little different, the makeup. Some of them do disclose their finance and things like that, but not all of them. But it would just put them in, have them kind of be held accountable almost the same way public schools are. Not quite, but we can't choose the students we want. We get the students we get. We can't send students away because we can't meet their needs. We can't, just take the best and the brightest and or take on special education students and then send them back to their sending schools because we can't meet their needs, but be able to say that we took special education students. So it will level the playing field somewhat, and I think that that's important. I don't know what the vote will be today, but I will say to you that I don't think charter schools are going away. They may not, become more. They may not become more prolific based on today's vote, whether or not the cap is up or down. But we also need to understand that public schools are held to such higher standards, that we're held to so many more regulations and procedures than charter schools. And charter schools can, appear on the surface to be very successful, but it doesn't take much digging to realize that what we're doing here in public education is so important and so needed and so hard. We're really working hard. Frontier's doing a marvelous job. We're such a successful, great school, great district. So that's my piece on the RISE Act. Hopefully it will level the playing field. Now, on the other hand, the Massachusetts Rural Schools Coalition is a coalition of superintendents across the western Massachusetts. And what they're trying to do is take the flat funding, the flat formula for funding Chapter 78, and use a tiered system to determine how much aid we would get. Schools that are rural schools that have declining enrollment, we are getting the same aid, Chapter 78, based on the same exact formula that an urban district, wealthy districts, poor districts, urban districts get when there's so many more students per whatever. As our enrollment declines, our Chapter 78 is based on enrollment. So we are looking at it. We all know that small schools have the best benefits. We are so fortunate in this district because our school is considered a smaller school. Students have a lot more benefits. You get to be known, you get to be, people just have a better understanding of these students because we are in a small school. It's not a factory school. We are hoping to adjust the Chapter 70. It's still a long ways off, but it is a coalition. The coalition has asked that we go to our school boards and ask them to support it. I'm not exactly there yet, but I would like you to know about the Massachusetts Rural Schools Coalition. I think you read about it in the paper. It has been developed by Mike Guernicotti from Mohawk Regional District. It seems really good. I'm not sure. There might be, and my concern is, as I get deeper into it, there might be some hidden drawbacks to, jumping completely on this boat. So I continue to go to the meetings. I continue to learn. and I will bring to you what I find. It, on the surface, it looks really good. Our school does fall into it based on the fact that we are declining enrollment. But I'm also a little bit on the fence because there's a couple of drawbacks. And when I can fully articulate them, I'll bring them to you. But I have heard a few things. So, and that's what I've been working with.
So thank you so much for bringing this. Obviously, we don't know what the outcome is yet for
not for a couple hours.
But we do know that the charter school debate is going to continue.
It will.
So I've heard Senator Rosenberg say that he supports this district wholeheartedly. Did you get a sense from him on what he thinks of this Chapter 70 and?
What exactly happened, and I think I could talk more easily about it than I did when trying to describe it. What exactly happened when we were at the table, and it was superintendents from all over. There was 15 of us, and then the senator. And what I realized was that he was talking about something completely different. He was talking about charter schools and helping to public schools to allay some of those costs help us with the cost of sending kids to charter schools and leveling the playing field somewhat, because they really have the advantage. And it's what Mike and what the Rural Schools Coalition is talking about is totally different, because that's state funding. Mm-hmm. So they were talking, and there are two different things. And I think for a while we kind of thought that maybe we could hook together and kind of join forces, but they're really two different things. One is about public school aid, and one is about, you know, charter school leveling, you know, charter school issue. So, I mean, he did say that he would like us, for each student that goes right off the top, we should get an extra $1,000, you know, to pay tuition for a child going to a charter school. But the Chapter 78 is based on enrollment. So Senator Rosenberg said we should talk even to schools in the eastern part of the state, because that's really where people listen, to districts that are having declining enrollment there as well. We are rural, we are in the western part of the state, but there are several in the eastern part of the state that are losing their population, and so that we would be able to combine forces with them. But I do think that I need to know more, but I do want everyone to be aware that this is out there and it sounds good, and we are included at this point, but we haven't really done anything yet. There's a big meeting later on in November out in the Quabbin, I think out near Quabbin, I think Murray Marshall is having it, superintendent out there. It's going to be something that we need to really investigate before we jump into that.
I think the one thing that we do really share with them is the concern over the rural transportation reimbursement formula. Mm-hmm. And I think he's doing really yeoman's work in that area, so I hope we can support that whole thing.
Right. But I think that was one of the drawbacks. I think if they do the Chapter 70, once I get all the information and how it would impact us, then that would be certainly something that, you know, we should think about supporting. But meanwhile, I'm not signing Frontier Regional up for anything at this point. Thank you.
No one else has anything else, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Moved.
Second. All those in favor? And we're out.